Hallelujah. Thank you all. Please be seated. Praise the Lord. You know, the Bible says where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the... When he was crucified, the Father saw to it that he was crucified in the midst. John in the book of Revelation tells us that he had a voice behind him. When he turned to see the voice, he saw the Lamb of God in the midst of the throne. When Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared to the disciples in the upper room in their midst. What do you suppose will happen when you put Jesus in the midst of your marriage? In the midst of your relationships with your children? In the midst of your life? You know, scientists tell us that there's an amazing phenomena with the atom. Like repels like, opposites attract, and yet the atom is held together. They cannot explain. They can go that far, they know there's an atom, but they can't explain why the atom is held together. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 1, in Christ, all things are held together. When Christ is in your life, you are held together. Amen. Your mind is held together. Your marriage is held together. Amen. And that's why God wants him to be in the midst. So today is all about him. Amen. It's all about him. I'd like for you to just imagine along with me as we go back to ancient Israel. If I were to ask you, because there's a lot of talk as if holiness and grace are on opposite ends or they are contrary to each other. Nothing could be further from the truth. The greatest holiness is grace, is hope, it's mercy. Right at the heart of God. Let me just bring you to ancient Israel. Back then, if I were to ask you a question, of all the nations of the world back then, which is the holiest nation of all? Your answer would be? Israel, set apart from all the nations. If I were to ask you, in all the land of Israel, where is the holiest city? Jerusalem, very good. Matt, you didn't know that, but you were trying to want, you thought it was cancer or something, but I saw that look, Matt. You're right, Jerusalem, Yerushalayim, the holiest city in all Israel. Now, in the city of Jerusalem, which is the holiest location? The Temple Mount, very good. That was for Cody, and that's from Cody. You know, with every succeeding generation, the wisdom grows. My friends, Matt and Laurie from TBN. You're right. Of the entire city of Jerusalem, the holiest location is the Temple Mount, where the temple was, the Temple of Solomon stood. Now, in the temple, which is the holiest of holiest. Very good. Matt Crouch. There is hope for you in a Hope Church. The holiest of holiest. In Hebrew, Kodesh Kadoshim. The holiest of holiest. What do you find there in the center? What's the centerpiece in the Holy of Holies? Mercy seat. I submit to you, right in the heart of God, the holiest thing you can find in the heart of God is mercy, grace, and hope. The things that we are sharing, the things that we are, Joel and I, our ministries, we're not just touching on peripherals. We are touching on the very heart of God itself. You know, every preaching should produce faith, hope, and love. I don't care how good your doctrine is, it can be dead orthodoxy. If it does not produce faith, hope, and love, it's nothing more than just empty, dry teaching. Souls are not saved, lives are not transformed. Now, when I observe the ministry of Pastor Joel, and thank you so much for this invite to be here again. with you and your lovely wife, Victoria. Victoria seems like she's still in her 20s. For you, brother, I'm calling by faith. You are still in your 20s. This goes back from last night, if you know what happened. I forgot what I'm going to say now. Faith, hope, and love. And now the greatest of this is faith. Now abides faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Now watch this. The Lord Jesus, when he spoke to the church of Ephesus in the book of Revelation, this was his indictment to them. Look up here. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, this thing says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst, there it is again, of the seven golden lampstands, the menorah. I know your works. Now, watch the order. I know your works, your labor, your perseverance, your patience. Look at that. Works, labor, patience. Something is missing. Works, labor, patience. Let's go to what Paul says in the book of 1 Thessalonians. Remembering without ceasing your work of faith, labor of love, patience of hope. Faith, hope, and love was missing in the church of Ephesus, and Jesus called their attention to it. You can have dead orthodoxy. In other words, you can have all the right doctrines, and you can speak against ministries that produce hope in people's lives, faith, and all that. But let me tell you this. That is what God is after. Amen. So the church of Ephesus had works, labor, and perseverance, but it's not out of faith. It's not out of love. It's not out of hope. The Bible says that the gospel of Christ must reveal, let me read it to you, Romans 1, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation. The dunamis of God in the Greek, the dynamite of God, the power of God to your salvation. And the word salvation there is all encompassing for healing, wholeness, peace of mind, relationships that is prosperous, well-being in your family. It's an all-encompassing word. So when God sent his son, God called his son salvation, Yeshua. And what is the power, definite article, what is the power of God unto salvation? More praying, more fasting? No, the gospel of Christ. All that is well and good, it should have its place, but it is the power of God. You can pray a lot and yet have no power. If you are missing the gospel, because the gospel of Christ, it is the power of God to your wholeness. For everyone who believes, to the Jew first and to the Greek. For in this gospel, make sure you have the right gospel. In this gospel that releases the power of God to salvation, the righteousness of God is revealed. Not the sinfulness of man, the righteousness of God, which is a gift. Amen. And the reason why God sent his son, he's the only, you know, in a few weeks' time, we're going to celebrate Christmas. Do you know that Jesus is the only baby born to die? Think about it. God sent his son to die. And he knew it. He lived a spotless life without blemish, a wonderful life. You know, he's altogether lovely. When he is firm, he's not hurtful. When he is kind, he's not soft. Every which way you look at Jesus, he's a man's man. His eyes would burn at evil, injustice. And yet, those same fire beckons in us. Fires of love. No one is as beautiful as our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. You know, whoever you can pin up in your room and all that, all the celebrities and all, they all have clay feet. With Jesus, he cannot disappoint you. He doesn't know how to disappoint you. He's altogether lovely. The fairest of 10,000, the most beautiful of all. The desire of all nations, the bright and morning star. The lion of the tribe of Judah, yet he is a lamb. Hallelujah. Meekness and majesty. Amen. He is holy, but he has a holiness that is approachable. And the Pharisees didn't like it. They wanted God to be confined in the Holy of Holies, but God, Jesus made God approachable. Amen. Sinners could touch him and not defile him. In fact, he changed them when they touched him. He didn't get what they got. They got what he is. Amen. Grace is greater than sin. If somebody says, well, sin stopped that revival. If sin can stop revival, it would never have begun. Because revivals happen where there's a lot of sin. That's why there's a need for revival. Right? Think. No, I tell you what stops revival. When man brings in their laws. Amen. Rules and regulations. Reintroducing of the law. That kills the revival. God sent his son that this might happen. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 21. For God made him to be sin for us who knew no sin. Jesus knew no sin, and God made him at the cross to be sin for us. That we who knew no righteousness, we might become the righteousness of God in him. Now, question, what are you today? I am. The power of I am. Somebody needs to write that book. What are you today? I am a sinner. I am an addict. I'm a recovering alcoholic. What am I? I am the righteousness of God in Christ. You gotta watch your I ams. So God made Jesus to be sin for us. He knew no sin. You say, Pastor Prince, how can you say that you are the righteousness of God? How can I say I am the righteousness of God having done no right thing? Well, if you answer me, how did Jesus become sin having done no sin? By the same token, Jesus became sin apart from his performance that you might be made righteous apart from your performance. It's a divine exchange. And you know, the most Christ-honoring thing you can do is to say thank you when someone gives you a gift. Can I have a good amen? Amen. And the worst thing you can do is say, hey, how much is that gift, yo? I want to pay. All right? That'd be insulting the giver. The pleasure of the giver is to have you just receive it and enjoy it. Amen. God wants you to stand tall and say, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. Great things happen when you say that. All the demons in hell don't want you to confess that. Amen. Religious spirits don't want you to confess that. They want you to confess, I'm a dirty old rotten sinner. I am this, I am that, except I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Now, I want you to just fasten your seatbelts. We are going on a journey, again, back to ancient Israel. But this time on a video, and I'll lead you along as we follow this Hebrew. He does not examine the sinner. He examines his lamb. All right, good? Okay. Now the sinner lays hands in identification with the lamb. All the sin of the sinner is now transferred into the spotless lamb, innocent lamb. Now watch this. All the spotlessness and the purity and the righteousness of the lamb is transferred to the sinner. Because the lamb is now in the place of the sinner, the lamb is killed as if it's a sinner. The Bible says, as the burnt offering goes up as a sweet smelling fragrance, the shofar sounds and there's a rainbow. Now he walks away with the righteousness of the lamb, attracting all the blessings of God, the favor of God, the goodness of God in his life. The lamb did not deserve to die. That man did not deserve to be blessed. But the lamb died and the man is blessed. This is your story, people. It's the greatest love story ever written in blood. Amen. Now, if you believe this,
what about holiness, Pastor Prince?
I'm coming to it. I just got through. You missed the point. The greatest holiness is hope and grace and mercy in the very heart of God. Now, let me say this to you. Okay, people, when you believe right, when you believe this, you believe right, you will live right. Holy, you become holy by accident. Amen. If you believe you are the righteousness of God in Christ, you will become holy by accident. And not only that, you'll find provisions coming your way. The favor of God, the goodness of God, apart from your performance. You know, we misconstrue that verse that Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, take no thought for your life. Don't worry about your life, what you shall eat, what you shall put on. Do not worry about tomorrow. Your Father knows you have need of all these things. And then Jesus says, but seek you first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Not your righteousness, not your performance, His righteousness, which comes as a gift. Seek first the kingdom of God. And what is the kingdom of God? It's not food and drink from the outside in. It is righteousness, peace, and joy from the inside out. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And watch this. And all these things, clothing, food, provisions, they will all be added to you. Amen. So, I used to use my faith to believe for so many things. I believe God for a car. I believe God for a house. I believe God for this. I believe God for a good-looking wife. I believe God, you know, when I was younger. And my faith became dissipated. Actually, there's an easy way to get all these things. God says, seek first the kingdom of God. And as if to underline it, the kingdom of God is righteousness, His righteousness. Seek first His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. It's called the righteousness by faith. Now, why is it called righteousness by faith? Because every day, you look at yourself in the mirror. By the end of the day, you won't feel righteous. You won't have done some righteous stuff. And yet, God wants you to know you are righteous by faith. Amen. And there's no reality like God's eyes. When God says you are righteous, you are righteous. God did not make believe Jesus carried our sins. He literally carried our sins. So it's not make believe, He made you righteous. Can I have a good amen? You see, the key to living a life of victory and overcoming life, a life of holiness, a God-honoring life, your best life, is not looking at your behavior. I should say like this. Always remember this. Never judge your standing, which is righteousness in God. You are righteous in Christ. Never judge your standing by your behavior. Always judge your behavior by your standing. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. Even if you're smoking, even if you're addicted to something, you are still the righteousness of God in Christ. But Pastor Prince, how can you say that when the person is still having... Let me read to you a testimony. And we have all kinds of testimonies coming into our ministry ever since I preached this. And I would preach like this years ago. I remember I just said, if you have got a bondage to smoking, while you are smoking, say, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. And pastors are so afraid of that. Hey, they will still do it. Except they won't confess they are the righteousness of God. People will still do it. So I said, confess. Call those things that are not as though they are. Amen. Confess. A great man once said, this is the number one need of the body of Christ. Righteousness. I think it was John Osteen. He has a book on it. And in the midst of your sin, if you're able to confess, I am the righteousness of God in Christ, something's going to happen. This is one of many testimonies we receive. And this is a brother, Billy from Minnesota. Praise the Lord, I have been freed of a drug addiction that I have struggled with for most of my adult life. For the last 2 years, I have been listening to Pastor Prince preach via television and podcasts. Because of what I've learned through his messages, I would say out loud, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. During the very moments of my drug abuse. You heard it right, y'all. During the very moments. It seemed a ridiculous thing to say while in the process of sinning. Yet, it had an enormous impact on my behavior. As I repeatedly confessed, I am the righteousness of God in Christ, the desire to use the drug became less and less until it finally left completely. Today, I no longer struggle with the addiction. Praise God, Pastor Prince has helped me to see my real identity in Christ. I am the righteousness of God in Christ, and this has caused me to live right. I now feed on God's word and pray in the Spirit more than before. Thank you for your teaching, Pastor Prince. Praise God. To God be the glory. And this is one of many testimonies we receive in our office every week. People being delivered from many deliverance from pornography. I will teach this. As you are watching pornography, confess I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. Everything inside you, everything about your flesh will scream, hypocrite, how can you say that? The devil will scream the loudest, you are a hypocrite. But yet, if you are able to confess, I am the righteousness of God in Christ, something is going to happen to you. We have so many testimonies of people who are set free from pornography just doing that. All kinds of addictions. Amen. Heresy, blasphemy. That's what the Pharisees always, you know, truth always sounds like heresy to the ones who are religious, when actually it's the truth that sets free. You see, when Jesus told the Jewish people of his day, you shall know the truth and the truth will set you free, it wasn't the law that's the truth. Because the Jewish people knew the law from age 5. They knew it by heart. He was talking to them about grace. Are you listening, people? Well, Pastor Prince, I believe that the Holy Spirit convicts people of sin, and when he convicts us, we need to respond and all that. Let me just tell you something that's going to blow your mind, okay? But because I'm a stickler for God's word, I'm going to show you from Scripture that the Holy Spirit has come to do 3 things, according to our Lord Jesus. And many a times, people are afraid of the infilling of the Holy Spirit. They do not know the Holy Spirit is that warm, friendly voice on the inside. He is a friend. He will lead you and guide you, amen, in paths of abundance and peace. So, because of wrong teaching, they relegate the Holy Spirit to a nagger. You know, nagger? Someone nagging all the time? You call it nagger here? We call it nagger in Singapore. Stop being a nagger. Nag, 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 nag. Don't look at your wife now. Stop nagging, woman! I'll beat the hell out of you. I'm the righteousness. Yeah, confess it. Before I show you that portion from what Jesus said about the Holy Spirit, let me tell you this. If you're wondering, whatever Joel is preaching about, the I am truths, and what Pastor Prince is talking about confessing I'm the righteousness of God, let me show you this. Isaiah the prophet saw you and I confessing our righteousness in Christ. Let me show you this. Isaiah 45. God is saying, I have sworn by myself, the word has gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return, that to me every knee shall bow. Just let you know, in Philippians, Paul quotes this verse. Paul says, at the name of Jesus, every knee bows. Now, and every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord. What does it mean to confess Jesus Christ is Lord? What does it mean? I submit to you, it's confessing Jesus as your righteousness. The context here. The next verse. He shall say, the man shall say, surely in the Lord I have righteousness and strength. That's a confession right there. Surely shall one say, in the Lord I have righteousness and strength. To him men shall come, and all shall be ashamed who are incensed against him. In the Lord all the descendants of Israel shall be justified, made righteous, and shall glory. So Isaiah saw a generation of people who will confess, in the Lord I have righteousness and strength. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Can I have a good amen, people? But Pastor Prince, that's all well and good. That's called positional righteousness. I'm talking about practical righteousness. You know something? You either are righteous or you are not, okay? All right, don't confuse me with all these theological jargons. Amen. There's a positional righteousness and there's a practical righteousness. Let me tell you this. There's no practical righteousness. Righteousness is a gift. Righteousness is a standing before God. There is practical holiness. Yes. But not practical righteousness. Because if you teach on practical righteousness, it's going to be like what Paul said in Romans 10. Paul says about Israel, I bear them witness, they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness, which is a gift, and seeking to establish their own righteousness, they claim that's practical righteousness, when I perform, when I seek my own righteousness. But Paul says, when they do that, they have not submitted to the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for everyone that believes. Amen. You are not to seek your own righteousness. You are righteous. You see, Christianity does not begin with that's the finishing goal, okay? The final post, the finishing post, all right? And the finishing post is completeness in Christ. I'm hoping one of these days I reach that finishing post. That's not Christianity. Christianity starts here. You start complete in Christ. Now, walk out your completeness. You start righteous in Christ. Now walk it out. Amen. You are born in the Holy of Holies, between the wings of the cherubim, in the secret place of the Most High, at the mercy seat. That's where you are born again. And now you walk it out. You go outside and you are blessing the people. That's where you start, people. Amen. You start seated in the book of Ephesians. Then you can walk worthy. If you sit well, you will walk well. If you rest well in Christ, you will perform well. And that's why the book of Ephesians starts off with a believer sitting down with Christ. Then the next part of Ephesians says, now walk worthy. How well you walk is how well you sit. Many Christians have it the opposite. They are trying to walk that they may sit one day. That's why Jesus rose on a Sunday. Sunday is not the final day. Sunday is the first day. Amen. For the Jewish people, their Shabbat, Sabbath, is Saturday. They have to work Monday, Tuesday, and then they rest. Jesus starts us off in the rest on Sunday. Now you can walk Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday in victory and power. Your first step towards your deliverance from the addiction is to realize you're not trying to be free, you are free. You're not trying to be righteous, you are righteous. Amen. But the moment the devil have you stand up from your seat, let me tell you this, God sits down. You want God to work for you? Sit down. God goes to work. Amen. When you rest, God works. When you work, God rests. We have forgotten the 12th commandment. Thou shalt not sweat. Amen. Do you know the very first place that redemption starts? Remember the movie The Passion? Where did the passion start? In the Garden of Gethsemane. The very place where Jesus sweat blood. Let me tell you something about sweat. God said to Adam and Eve after the sin, by the sweat of your face, you will eat bread. Now another Adam in another garden, sweat, blood. But because there's a redeeming quality to his blood, when he sweat blood on our behalf, he redeemed us from the curse of sweat. Hallelujah! Amen! Now you get the things of God without sweat. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't sweat it. Look at somebody else and say, too blessed to be stressed. I mentioned just now, the Holy Spirit convicts us. I have not said it. This is the first time I'm saying. The Holy Spirit is in the life of the believer to convict him of righteousness. How can you say that, Pastor Prince? I didn't say it. Jesus did. In the upper room, this is what Jesus said in John 16. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. So what's going to say is the truth. It's not Pastor Prince saying it. A lot of people compliment me too much. They say, Pastor Prince said that. Pastor Prince, no, I didn't. Sometimes I feel a bit cheap just reading the Bible. If people just read their Bibles, look at this. I'm telling you the truth, he says. It is to your advantage that I go away, because if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you, the Holy Spirit. But if I depart, I'll send him to you. Next. When he has come, watch this, he will convict the world of what? Sin. Have you noticed it's singular? Americans. Have you noticed it's singular? And of righteousness. And of judgment. So the Holy Spirit comes to convict us of three things. The world of three things, right? Sin, righteousness, and judgment. Don't forget the order. Now, if he had left it like that, I'm telling you, the religious leaders would go wild and crazy with this. There it is. He convicts us of sin. And he convicts you of judgment. Righteousness, I don't understand, but he lets you know that judgment is coming. Well, you can say whatever you want to say, but thank God Jesus sort of preempted that. I thank God for Lord Jesus. He explained what the Holy Spirit convicting of sin and righteousness and judgment is all about. Next few verses, he says, of sin, because they do not believe in me. There's only one sin the Holy Spirit convicts the world of: unbelief in Christ. Only one sin. He's not out every day trying to convince, because you have belief on Christ. For those of you who have, you have belief on Christ, right? There was a time in your life he convicted you of your unbelief, of sin, the sin of unbelief. And once you have belief on Christ, what does he do? The next line, next verse. Of righteousness. For the believer, he convicts you of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. And what about judgment? Of judgment, because the ruler, the devil, the ruler of this world is judge. It is not your judgment. Oh, people, come on. It is not convicting you of sin every day. He's not that voice that nags at you saying, you have sinned, you have sinned, you have sinned, you have sinned, you have sinned. It's hard to live with someone like that. Don't say amen at this time. Probably the one is sitting beside you right now. It's not easy to live with somebody who is always nagging, nagging, nagging. You know, it's hard. Shut up, woman! That's the 5th million time this week. Number of grace, dear. The Holy Spirit is not like that. He doesn't like. He's that. He convicts us, yes, of sin, yes. But the Bible tells, Jesus tells us what sin it is. Of unbelief in him. Then, when he comes to dwell in you, he convicts you every day of righteousness. Why? Because every day we look at evidence, seemingly evidence, seeming evidence that says you're not righteous. So he tells you, no, son, you are the righteousness of God. That's the voice of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit convicts you of righteousness. How often do you hear that preach? Let me ask you, how often do you hear this conviction of the Holy Spirit being preached? Are we reading the same Bible? Oh, I forgot. I'm sharing from the Singapore Bible. And it convinces you your enemy is defeated. The devil is judged. Broken to pieces. Amen. And every single day he convicts you. You are the righteousness, son. I love the Holy Spirit, don't you? And many a times, we who believe in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, we think that he has come just to give us the gifts. The very first mention, and there's a law called the law of Bible interpretation called the law of first mention. The very first mention of the Holy Spirit in the book of Romans says that the Holy Spirit, because the love of God maketh not ashamed, or is coming. Look at this. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. The love of God. You know, there's a first mention of the Holy Spirit in the book of Romans. He comes in to tell you God loves you. Not love for God. He's not telling you to love God. He's telling you about how much God loves you. That's what the Holy Spirit does. Amen. Now, Peter was preaching in the house of Cornelius, the Italiano. And the Bible says Peter was hungry. He smelled spaghetti. Okay, that part was added. I'm sorry. You don't add to the Bible, okay? And he was hungry. He had a vision from God. And he went on his way to Caesarea. In Caesarea, the house of Cornelius, who was an Italian centurion, he was there. And Peter came and Peter says, it's not right for us Jews to fellowship with the Gentiles. But nonetheless, I had a vision that God sent me here. And he started preaching. And most of us know Acts 10, his sermon, Acts 10, 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit with power, who went about doing good. I mean, all of us in the Word of Faith, we know that verse by heart. But we do not know how the sermon ended. The sermon, the crux of that sermon, when the Holy Spirit responded, was this. Peter came to this point, Peter said, to Christ, all the prophets witness that through his name, the name of Jesus, whoever believes in him will receive forgiveness, remission of sins. While Peter was still speaking these words, what words? Not words of legalism, not words of judgment, words of forgiveness, the Holy Spirit fell. The Holy Spirit fell. It's as if God says, that is so good, I'm coming right now. We know Peter's sermon, the one we memorize, is Acts 10:38. And that's wonderful, God honoring Jesus. But we should memorize this verse. This is the last line of Peter's sermon, because Peter could not go on anymore after that. The Holy Spirit fell. By the way, the word fell in the original Greek here is the same word used of the prodigal son's father when he embraced his son, when his son came home. The Holy Spirit embraced all the people there with the love of God. Notice again, while Peter was still speaking these words, I'm here to tell you, people, listen, if these words mean so much to the Holy Spirit 2,000 years ago, how much more today when it's being preached by a smiling preacher? And God loves you. Amen. No wonder the Holy Spirit falls on those people. They don't even know it's the Holy Spirit. A few weeks ago, I was at my hairdresser, hair salon place, and to get my hair cut for this tour. And so happens that it's a chain of hair salons. It's a chain of hair salons all over Singapore. And so happens that the CEO of the hair salon was there. She roughly knew who I was, that kind of thing, but she wasn't a believer. By the end of my haircut, she got saved. And just sharing grace. And the hairdresser that I usually go to, all right, she was there. She asked me a question. She also received Christ, all right? And she asked me a question while she was washing my hair. She said, just now when you prayed, and I prayed along with you, what was that warm feeling I had all over me? I felt so hot, she said. Isn't it wonderful when people are just baby Christians expressed to you? The world needs to hear the good news. God loves it when you know, his people are preaching the good news. But we've made the good news no good news. Imagine if I come to you and I say, I'm going to give you my car. Now, I don't have a Rolls Royce, but supposing I have a Rolls Royce. I'm going to give you my brand new Rolls Royce. Free. Completely free. It's yours, man. You only pay me $30 every month. I just spoil it. And many a times, that's the kind of message we have. Yes, it's free. It's free, but we put something else. If it's free, it's free. Receive the gift and then be changed and be transformed. You don't clean yourself before you come to Jesus. How many of you, show me your hands. How many of you clean yourself before you take a bath? No, you take a bath and then you are clean. Come to Jesus as you are. He will clean you up. Amen. Let the Holy Spirit convict you of righteousness. Amen. Another, you know, we have a witness of the Holy Spirit. You know, people say, well, I just sense the Holy Spirit. He was grieved when that lady walked into the cell group just now. You know, our care group has been going on really fine until she stepped in. And I felt, I don't know why, the Holy Spirit in me is grief. No, the Holy Spirit is not grief. You are just plain jealous, you ugly thing. Well, she has a lot of makeup on and the Spirit is grieved. We charismatics, we are grieved over anything that we are grieved and blame it on the Holy Spirit. And young people think you're strange. We don't like someone, we say, I don't know why, I'm just grieved. You know, the only time the word grief, not the Holy Spirit, the only time in Scripture it appears, grief, not the Holy Spirit, in the New Testament, is right after it says, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace to the hearers, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit. In other words, any words that does not minister grace grieves the Holy Spirit. It is not profanities. I'm against profanities. I'm against vulgarities. But he's not talking about that. He's talking about words that minister undeserved favor to people. You say kind things that they don't deserve. That, if the Holy Spirit can be grieved with non-gracious words, likewise, he can be happy. He can be pleased when your words are full of grace. Amen. Words that minister grace means undeserved, unearned favor. You minister to someone, even though they don't deserve it. Like I look at Joel right now and I say, you're really good looking. Unearned, undeserved favor. Yeah. Let me show you a witness of the Holy Spirit that is seldom preached, even in Hebrews chapter 10. There is this witness of the Holy Spirit. Now, what is a witness in court? Well, he's there. He sits on the bench. He's a witness means he's there to witness to something that has happened, to testify of the truth, right? Well, the Holy Spirit is also a witness. But I tell you this, you hardly hear this witness being preached. In Hebrews 10, it tells you the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us. For after he had said that this is the covenant that I'll make with them after those days, quoting the new covenant, I'll put my laws in their hearts and in their minds I'll write them. Then the Holy Spirit adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. He witnesses to us. Why? Because there was a time the Holy Spirit saw all our sins, all your lawless deeds and mine. But that was at the cross. He saw them placed on the Son of God, the divine substitute, and the Holy Spirit witnessed him being judged, being condemned, being punished, stroke after stroke after stroke after stroke of all God's divine retribution and wrath against all our sins fell upon his Son, for God ordained it to be so. The God who loved us so much sent his Son for this purpose, that he might die as our substitute. And stroke after stroke fell on Jesus until Jesus cried, finished! Hallelujah. There is no more wrath left. And the Holy Spirit is a witness to what happened. That today in your heart, he witnessed your sins. God remembers no more. Your sins, God remembers no more. Do you hear this witness being preached? No, it is. She has such a heavy makeup on in church this Sunday. I don't know why. It just grieves the spirit in me. No, you are just jealous. Well, Pastor Prince, do you believe a woman should have makeup? Yes. A lot of it. God knows many of us need help. Even an old bun looks nice when you paint the bun. Slap it on, sister. Help yourself and help your husband. Amen. We are grieved with everything that we are not happy about. And we don't realize that we are putting the Holy Spirit. What about unpardonable sin, Pastor Prince? The unpardonable sin appears in Matthew 12. And Matthew 12 was the final rejection of Jesus Christ. That's why in Matthew 13, he preached in parables from then on. The seven kingdom parables. To hide them from... It was a judgment on the Jewish leaders because they rejected him. Matthew 12, where blasphemy of the Holy Spirit was mentioned, they rejected Jesus in all three official glories of Jesus as prophet, priest, and king. Number one, Jesus said, a greater than the temple, than the priest is here. Who is that? Jesus. In chapter 12 of Matthew. In the same chapter, he says, a greater than Jonah is here. Who is Jonah? A prophet. He's the greater prophet. They rejected him as the greater priest, as the greater prophet. And then he says, a greater than Solomon is here. Who is Solomon? A king. He is the greater king. They rejected Jesus in his three official glories, as prophet, priest, and king. And then he says about the unpardonable sin. is the sin of knowing full well who Jesus is, and you keep on rejecting him. A believer cannot commit this sin. There is no unpardonable sin for a believer. And it was unique for them because they saw him in the flesh, which is not something that anyone can commit today. But you can be hardened by consistent rejection of his love. But friend, why would you want to reject his love? He loves you. Amen? I want you to sit back and watch this video that our team has done for many, many years. You know, the movie The Passion is amazing. It's a wonderful movie, right? But there are people who came out of the movie and they blame the Jews and the atrocities they did. Some blame the Romans, but none of them saw the love of God being portrayed, except for the believers. So I figured that, you know, what happened spiritually is more important. So I told my team, for years I tried to describe what I saw happen at the cross, but I could not, words fail me. But I saw it, I could see in the spirit, and yet my words fail me when I describe it. So finally I got my team and I explained to them, you know, what I see and all that. They tried to come up with it. I kept on sending them back to their drawing board. They came back again, and finally we got something here that I think is going to bless you. It's not fully what I saw, but it comes close. And as you watch this, I want you to know this. This really happened 2,000 years ago because God loves you. Watch.
Father, into your hands, I commit my spirit.
Praise the Lord. That's how much He loves you. Come on, people. Hallelujah. Give your praise to the one who gave His life for us, the Son of God who loved me, gave Himself. Come on, church. Rejoice. This is your Savior. This is your King. This is your God. Hallelujah. This is your God.
Can I have your book, Joseph? Thank you so much. Well, remain standing one moment before we leave this morning. Maybe there's somebody here or listening, watching maybe that is not at peace with God. And it's so easy, like Pastor Joseph said, it's a free gift of salvation, of righteousness. And with our heads bowed in prayer, I'm just going to ask you to pray a prayer with me today. And just mean it from the bottom of your heart and you can receive Jesus right now. Why don't you say it after me? Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Come into my heart. Wash me clean. I make you my Lord and Savior. Amen. Well, you prayed that prayer. We believe you got the free gift of righteousness. You became born again. Come back and be with us on a regular basis. Come on, let's tell Pastor Joseph how glad we are to have him here with us today at Lakewood. So great, Pastor Joseph. All right. Joseph has his new book out. He's going to be signing right out there in the lobbies after the service. But we love you very much. Until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show you His favor and have mercy on you. And may the Lord watch over you and give you His peace. God bless you. Have a great week, a faith-filled week. We'll see you back soon.
Wow, what an amazing time we've had this weekend with Pastor Joseph Prince. We're so glad that you've joined us, whether it's online at lakewoodchurch.com or if it's Sirius XM channel 128. It has been such a wonderful experience being in God's presence this weekend, and we're so glad that you joined us and got to experience this with us. Pastor Joseph Prince has preached on God's grace and His mercy and His love all weekend long. And I want you to know this morning that God does love you. He is madly in love with you. And I love the fact that he shared that the disciple John was the one who wrote in his own gospel that he was the one that Jesus loved. And Pastor Prince said that he had a revelation that God loved him. And I think that that's such a powerful picture for all of us to realize how much God does love us. I've written a song recently called Always Only Love. And in the chorus, it says, "Faithfully, Lord, you pursue me. Arms wide open, you run to me." And that's such a picture of the prodigal son when he came home, how the father opened his arms and ran to him when he saw him. And I want to encourage you today, if you're in a situation or facing a challenge where you feel that you're alone or that maybe God doesn't understand where you are, and you may be wrestling with the situation in your mind, I want to encourage you this morning that God knows exactly where you are. He cares about where you are. He sees you. He's completely aware of your circumstances and your situation, and He loves you. We here at Lakewood Church love you as well. We want you to know that we're praying for you, and we believe that your best days are just ahead.